by getting this picture, we can actually tell the makeup of the universe and how the universe is going to behave throughout its 14 billion year cosmic history. So that's why people are really excited about the CMB and why it's a cornerstone, really, of our understanding of the universe.
This is the Discovery Files podcast from the U.S. National Science Foundation. I'm Nate Potker. America's longstanding innovation in astronomy has played a vital role in uncovering the mysteries of our universe. NSF-supported observatories have shattered the boundaries of scientific knowledge while advancing and expanding humanity's understanding of the origin and evolution of the early universe. We're joined by Tobias Marich, a professor in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Johns Hopkins University, and Yunyang Li, a postdoctoral researcher at the Kavli Institute for Cosmological Physics at the University of Chicago. They're both part of a team researching the early universe using the Cosmology Large Angular Scale Surveyor, or CLASS, an array of telescopes situated at high altitude in the Atacama Desert of Chile. Thank you both for joining me today.
Hi, thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure to be here.
I want to start with the big question. What are these new results that you've recently published in the Astrophysical Journal that you're going to be sharing with us today?
Well, fundamentally, the result is a map of the night sky, but instead of the stars, which we see with our eyes, we mapped invisible microwave light. This lies between on the electromagnetic spectrum between radio waves and the infrared. And by analyzing this map of the sky in the microwaves, we can estimate when the first stars formed, the so-called cosmic dawn.
So you mentioned this cosmic dawn era. What is that and how might you see it from Earth?
Right. So cosmic dawn is when the first stars formed. The universe started out just full of gas, and this gas had to collapse under its own gravity and form stars. And when those stars formed, they gave off light, which we can see with our telescopes like JWST. And they also impacted the gas by ionizing the gas with their intense radiation, that is stripping off the electrons from the protons in the gas. There are a few ways to see cosmic dawn. As I mentioned with JWST, James Webb Space Telescope, astronomers can literally detect and study these first galaxies that harbor the first stars. But there are questions there. You see the light coming off of it, but what about, you know, what is the sense of the stars in them? And it leaves some pieces of the puzzle. And so on our side, with our telescopes, what we actually see is not the stars themselves, but that ionized gas. In fact, we see the impact of the ionized gas on microwave light that comes from the Big Bang. And by detecting that signature in the microwave light, we're able to know more things about the first stars. So these different data sets from JWST, from our telescopes, are like different pieces of this cosmic dawn puzzle. You need all of them to get the total picture.
Now, you talked about the microwaves there a little bit. That is the cosmic microwave background, correct?
Right.
Can you explain what that is for people that don't really know? Why is it important to understand cosmic microwave background?
Sure. So the cosmic microwave background is CMB. This light comes from the Big Bang. It's important because it provides a picture of the beginning of the universe. If the universe were a 100-year-old man, the CMB is from when that man was one day old. So in this analogy, a map of the CMB, like the ones we make, is, you know, essentially a baby picture of this imagined senior universe. By getting this picture, we can actually tell the makeup of the universe and how the universe is going to behave throughout its 14 billion year cosmic history. So that's why people are really excited about the CMB and why it's a cornerstone, really, of our understanding of the universe.
Can I ask you about the telescopes you're using, the Cosmology Large Angular Scale Surveyor Array? What is that tool?
The Cosmology Large Angular Scale Surveyor, or CLASS, is an array of microwave telescopes. They operate high in the Andes of northern Chile. The telescopes have a special design that enables them to measure this microwave light from cosmic dawn. But in addition to the telescopes, you know, CLASS is also our team, our collaboration. which is made up of largely students and people who just received their PhDs. So one of the exciting stories about class is not only is it a high-tech telescope measuring this, you know, cool thing about the universe, but, you know, it also has contributions from, you know, at this point, I think it's about 20 PhD students and about 50 undergrads. So it's a great, it's both the people and the telescopes.
How do you use the data that you get from these telescopes to look back in time?
It's a telescope, so for every astrophysical measurement, we're always looking back in time because it takes time for the light to travel from where it emits to us. For us, we're looking at CMB. As I said, it's coming from the very early time of the universe, so essentially 14 billion years ago. This CMB actually contains the information about the very early stage of the universe. So by looking at CMB, we're directly looking at the universe in its infant stage. And while these CMB photons propagates towards us, they almost move freely, but occasionally these CMB photons can interact with the matters along the way. And when this happens, this interaction will distort the patterns of the CMB photons, and we can analysis these imprints and to tell what's happening. In the evolution of the universe, there is an epoch called Reionization. This is the time when the first light turns on the first star and galaxies are formed. And when these first galaxies are formed, they produce these ionizing photons that ionize the neutral atoms in the universe and release a large amount of electrons. And these electrons will scatter with the CMB photons to create slight polarization signals. And CLAST is designed to measure these small polarization patterns on the sky. So our measurements are essentially looking at how this reionization is happening and how these first star galaxies are formed.
You mentioned reionization there. I want to ask you, what is the significance of measurement reionization?
The reionization is a process when the first stars and galaxies are formed, which happens at a very long time ago. So it is otherwise very difficult to directly observe how the first star galaxy formed. But with the CMB, we are very sensitive to these free electrons that are being released during the reionization process. So in a way, CLAST is telling us about how reionization happened. Within the standard cosmological model, the reionization is actually the least constrained parameter so far. And these parameters are intimately related to all these other cosmological parameters. So tightening this measurement will also greatly advance our understanding in other aspects of cosmology.
What are the challenges of working with data from space versus Earth? Like, I know one of the big deals of this particular study is that you were able to register this from the ground.
Space is a very stable environment. The sky is very clear from outer space. But that said, it's expensive to operate an instrument in space or to build, you know, a space telescope and to launch it. And you usually don't get a chance to modify or experiment with that telescope much once it's launched, right? On the other hand, the ground is more economical. And you get a chance to continuously experiment and adapt and develop your telescope, which is important for this measurement since it's so hard. On the ground, the sky is obscured by the atmosphere. There are spurious sources of light from different things on the Earth. And you know, you have to deal with things like weather and other sources of instability.
Dr. Lee, what was the novel hardware approach that you used to get around the atmospheric challenges?
So as we said, the most impact from the atmosphere is the turbulent atmospheric noise. But luckily, most of these atmospheric noise is unpolarized. And the signals that we're looking for from the CMB is a polarized signal, which means we have rooms to be clever there. And the solution that we come up with is to use a technology called the polarization modulator. And the idea is that we find a way this device can couple to the polarization signals from the sky and move it or modulate it up to higher frequency, because most of the unpolarized atmospheric noise are at lower frequencies. So this approach effectively separates the signal that we're trying to look for from these atmospheric and terrestrial noises. And from our latest result, this actually proved to be working remarkably well. In fact, we've seen noise performance comparable to what can be achieved from space-based observatories.
Like, what about the desert of Chile makes it a good place for astronomical observations?
This desert in Chile, the Atacama Desert, is one of the driest places in the world. What matters to us, of course, is the atmosphere. In this desert in particular, the atmosphere doesn't contain a lot of water vapor. Now, water vapor absorbs and emits microwaves. So the less water vapor between you and outer space, the better. Our telescopes also are at a very high elevation. They're at 17,000 feet or 5,000 meters. That's the same as Everest Base Camp. So we also benefit from having a thin as well as a dry atmosphere.
I want to ask you about modifying the telescopes. I know there was a hardware piece that was part of this particular research, and I know you've done some other modifications to the class array over time there.
Right. So this result relies on really on one of the telescopes in the array, one that's most sensitive to the CMB. This was installed back in 2018. And at the beginning, we had, you know, our first round of detectors, which were good, but not great. And so we were able to go back to the drawing board in the following years, modify, update the detectors, and achieve the sensitivities we needed. And so we installed those later, and those new detectors actually played a big role in the results we currently have. Even further than that, not part of the current results, we've also modified the front end of our telescopes, which encodes the signal at a high frequency, much like your AM radio encodes signals to get it out of the noise. We took this so-called modulator, and we switched it out for another one that's more efficient, and we think we'll have lower systematic error. So that's the type of modifications and experimentation you can do over the years as you learn, studying the data, going back to the lab, working with your collaborators. That is more, obviously more difficult to do if your telescope's way out in space.
So thinking about processing that data and the hardware changes, are you guys using software such as AI applications at this point? How are you seeing AI being used in astronomy?
Yeah, so no one would accuse me of being an expert in AI, but I also don't live under a rock. And I see AI entering astronomical research in two realms where it really shines. The first is classification. So for the same reason AI can detect whether there's a driver in a car, it can also detect whether there's a supernova in a galaxy. The other realm is analyses that aim to extract information about the universe from very complex data sets. So in particular, scientists now are trying to derive information about the universe from matter that's undergoing advanced stages, what physicists is called nonlinear gravitational collapse. That's pretty complicated to describe, and by throwing AI at it, there's a bit of an easier. There's more of a chance to sort of short circuit some of the difficulties. In our particular work, people have used AI to look at separating the CMB from microwaves that are coming from our own galaxy. That's something people have done. We didn't use that in this particular analysis because it wasn't needed, but AI is making inroads and you're just gonna see more and more of it, especially as you get these larger and larger data sets that we're expecting from these big telescopes over the next 10 years.
Before we move much further into the future, I wanna backtrack a little bit and ask you about how NSF support has impacted your career, from a career award in more recent years, all the way back to, I think you had a graduate research fellowship earlier. Can you talk about how some of these things have played a role as you've gone along?
Yeah, I can still remember the evening when I found out about the NSF Graduate Research Fellowship. I was on a graduate school visit with some classmates who also happened to receive the award, and we all celebrated together. Back then, you could actually use the GRF to pursue study abroad. So I used the first year to study physics in Cambridge, and that was very formative for me. I then returned to Princeton and used the GRF to do my first work on the CMB in Chile. As an assistant professor here at Hopkins, I've used the career grant to sponsor students who have done the cosmological analysis of the class data. So it, you know, that very much plays into the results that we're talking about today.
Now, for my last question, I want to ask each of you, what's next in your career? What's next in the research?
Our next goal is to significantly improve our current measurement. So far, we have demonstrate that this challenging measurement from the ground is feasible, and now we're working to scale it up. We've already deployed new instrument in the field with the new polarization modulation technique that effectively doubles our observation efficiency. And right now, as we speak, we have a team that are shipping new telescopes to Chile, and it will be assembled and start observation in a couple of weeks. So this new addition will dramatically boost our mapping speed. And with a few more years of observation and analysis, we expect to make substantial improvement over the current results.
This breakthrough result, I'm excited to capitalize and expand the telescope array in the ways we know we need to get to our goal of really pinning down this cosmic dawn. I'm also excited about working with folks, you know, studying galaxies in JWST, and there's other ways of getting a cosmic dawn, you know, looking directly at not the ionized gas, but the pre-ionized gas, the neutral gas. There's a lot of interesting work to be done here. It's one of the epochs of the universe we really don't know that much about. So I foresee myself spending a lot of time on that.
What difference would having something like your 90 hertz telescope that you're using here stationed on the moon, what difference would that make for the data you're getting?
We only ever see one side of the moon. So the other side of the moon is always pointed away from the Earth. So that's great because it shields you from the Earth. And so it's very quiet. It's a unique environment that doesn't have a lot of the spurious signals that we have on the Earth. It's like being a space telescope essentially, except for, you know, you can build up larger and over time. And in principle, if we do have facility to travel back and forth from the moon, really going out on a limb here, but you know, probably it'll happen. We can have that same benefits we have in terms of, you know, building out and experimenting with the telescope as we do here on Earth.
Special thanks to Tobias Marriage and Yunyang Li. For the Discovery Files, I'm Nate Potker. Please subscribe wherever you get podcasts, and if you like our program, share with a friend and consider leaving a review. Discover how the U.S. National Science Foundation is advancing research at nsf.gov.